this place. Welcome to this 11 o'clock, the first Sunday morning of our Revive 2024. Some great hymns we get to sing together. Let's stand as we do it right now.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deep we stayed within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despair and cry. From the waters lifted me, now say,
could help. Love lifted.
Amen. Amen. Thank you all for being here this morning. Before you're seated, turn to three or four people, welcome them to this service, and say thank you for the blood of Jesus. Find your way back to your seats. Thank you again for being in this service this morning. We want to take a moment to welcome you if you're a first-time guest with us this morning. Thank you for choosing this third service on Sunday morning. We have three on Sunday morning here at Quail. We have an 8:15 right here. Our 9:30 service is a modern service across campus in our worship center and right back here at 10:55. Thank you for being a part of this service today. This is your first visit with us. We'd like to connect with you. And if you don't mind, there's a little connect card in front of you. And if you could take that card, give us some information about yourself throughout our service today, that would be great. And at the close of our service, if you just want to hang on to that little card, you can bring it to a reception area that's just for you as a first-time guest. If you'll exit right here to the right, just take a few more steps, you'll see our reception area for you. Our pastor will be there, some of our staff. We want to connect with you. That's an important word for us here at Quail Springs Baptist Church. If you've not yet joined or thought about looking into joining one of our Connect groups, they meet throughout our building at 9:30 before this service. And if you come next week a little bit early, you want to find a Connect group that's right for you, just find one of our welcome stations, welcome centers around our campus. There are people there that'll help you find a class and give you a personal escort so you won't have to worry about wandering around the church. We'll put you in a class that's just right for you. Thank you again for being here this exciting service this morning. Look at our screens for a few announcements.
Today is the official kickoff of Revive. We invite you to come back tonight at 5:30 p.m. in the Worship Center to hear from our good friend, Dr. Jeff DiGiacomo. He'll be joined by worship artist Patrick Mayberry. Starting tomorrow, we'll have services every night through Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. in the Worship Center. We're also hosting a lunch on Tuesday at noon, and we'll have our regular fellowship dinner on Wednesday night at 5 p.m. We hope you can make it to one or all of the services, as it's going to be an incredible time of teaching, worship, and drawing close to God. Next Sunday, April 21st, we will have Baptism Sunday. Across all three services, there will be opportunities to get baptized immediately. We'll provide everything you need. So if you make a last-minute decision or forget something, we've got you covered. Even if you already know Jesus as Lord and Savior but have not been baptized, don't wait. This is the perfect opportunity. You might have noticed we have replaced bulletins this week with Revive booklets. Those have the schedule for the week as well as announcements for upcoming events. Be sure to pick one up on your way out. We hope to see you back tonight.
Praise the Lord. How many of you are thankful that you're saved today? Say amen. Amen. God is so good, and I am so thankful that you are here for the beginning of our Revive Week here at Quail Springs Baptist Church. Beginning this morning and throughout this week, up through Wednesday night, we're going to be having Revive services. Great, great preachers from all over the United States who are going to be coming and preaching God's Word to us, and then incredible times of worship each night. You don't want to miss. So I want to encourage you, pray every day for Revive and then attend from beginning to end and invite someone each night. Notice I made all those rhyme for you there. Pray every day, attend from beginning to end, invite someone each night. And I promise you, God has something He wants to do in your life. In fact, in our services so far this morning, we've had people make decisions to trust Jesus Christ as Savior in every service. And we praise the Lord for that. Praise God for the way He's working. I'm thankful to be able to introduce to you our guest speaker for this morning. He's Shane Pruitt. Shane is the National Next Gen Director for the North American Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention. God is using him to preach God's Word literally to hundreds of thousands of students and young people every year. And God's anointing is just on his life. He's seeing so many people come to know Jesus as Savior as he preaches God's Word. He is no stranger to us here at Quail Springs. He's been a speaker for our Gravity Weekend. He's been a speaker for Parent Link here. He's been a multiple speaker multiple times at Falls Creek. And so God's just used him in incredible ways here in Oklahoma and at Quail Springs. He and his family live in Texas. He and his wife, Casey, have six kids total, one with the Lord. Church family, will you please express your appreciation and thanks? Welcome Shane Pruitt to our fellowship today. Shane, we're so glad to have you here with us today. I'm going to ask you, if you will, to stand with me as we go before the Lord in prayer. Our ushers are coming to take their places to receive the offering today. And we're standing today in prayer as a reminder that in these days we want to stand in prayer for the nation of Israel. I know that you have been watching, as Michelle and I have, especially in these past 24 hours, as the situation there has escalated with the attacks coming from Iran. We're thankful that Israel has been able successfully to defend itself against those attacks so far. But today we want to pray for the people of Israel. The Word of God commands us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And so we want to pray for that today, and especially for those who are in difficult places today. Join with me as we pray. Lord, we love you and praise you. We thank you, God, that you are the God who saves. We thank you, God, that you are the God who has revealed himself to us through your word. And Father, we come before you and we know from your word that you are the God of Abraham and Jacob. You are the God who sent your son, Jesus, through your people, the people of Israel. And so God, we pray for those who are in dangerous places in Israel today. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray, God, for you to give wisdom and guidance to those who are making decisions. We pray, God, that you would give the people of Israel the strength to be able to prevail against those who are attacking them. And then, Father, I pray today, Lord, that you would bring Jewish people to know Jesus as their Savior, their Messiah, their Lord. God, we ask that. And Lord, we ask that for others who are separated from you because they've never trusted Jesus as Savior. God, worldwide, so many need to turn to Jesus. We ask, God, that the nations would turn to Jesus and be saved. And now, Father, we pray for this hour. Lord, we thank you for the way you are moving and working. We thank you, Lord, for people who today have trusted Jesus as Savior in our services. And Lord, I pray for those who are here today without Christ. Lord, show them how much you love them. Show them how much they need you, that today they might turn to Jesus and be saved. Thank you, God, for bringing Shane Pruitt to us. Lord, I pray that you would just anoint his lips and anoint our ears, that we would hear what you have for us today as he comes to bring your message to us. We thank you for the joy of giving to you today. And Lord, I pray that you would take the gifts that we bring and use them to take the gospel to our city, our nation, and to all the world. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We pray all these things in Jesus' precious name. And church, if you agree with that prayer, will you say amen? Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Morning. How is everybody? Is everybody good? Awesome. Are you glad to be here? I am glad to be with you. God has been good already this morning, and I believe he is not done yet. I think God's still going to do some incredible things, even in this service, and we're glad that you're here. In fact, why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, I'm so glad you got to see me this morning. Why don't you tell them that? Well, what a joy it is to be with you. I learned a long time ago that a good pastor is a gift from our great God, and God has blessed this church with an incredible pastor. Can we give the Lord a hand for Dr. Stephen Rummage? And thank you, Pastor, for having me, friend. Such a blessing to me personally. I know he's a blessing to you as well. I do want to tell you about a couple resources that I brought with me that will be available right outside the chapel after the service. I would love to meet you. I brought a book with me that I wrote called 9 Common Lies Christians Believe, and in it is really talking about some different cultural cliches that we as Christians tend to share with each other, but they're not biblically true. For example, have you ever heard this cliche before? God won't give you more than you can handle. What about this one? Follow your heart. What about this one? When a loved one dies, God gains another angel. What if those are more than sentiments? What if they're actually lies that will hold us back in our faith? Because what we need is the truth of God's word, not cliches. So each chapter takes one of those cliches and then gives a biblical truth to move forward with. That's available. Also, wrote a book called Calling Out the Called, Discipling Those Called to Ministry Leadership. So if you feel that God has called you to leadership and to ministry, or know somebody that God has called to ministry leadership, that's just a great resource to help you understand that calling, what that means, and some next steps. And then the third one is a brand new one that I just wrote with Lifeway. It's actually a Bible study called Revival Generation, Awakening to a Movement of God, and it's specifically for young people. So if you're a teenager, college student, young adult, or you have a child or grandchild that is, that's just a great Bible study that does a deep dive on words in the Bible associated with revival and awakening. Words like repentance and holiness and obedience. There's a devotional in it, prayer guides, all kind of good things. Anyway, those are available. Would love to meet you. They'll be outside the chapel after the service. But we're going to dive in to the greatest book of all, and that's God's holy word. If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, turn to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, or if it's on your phone or tablet, you can scroll to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1 is right before Colossians chapter 2. Does that help anybody? Now, I want to tell you from the beginning, church, I didn't grow up in church. In fact, I didn't become a Christian until I was 21. I always say the first 21 years of my life, I was building my testimony. You know what I mean? God saved me out of a lot and from a lot. So I remember vividly of what it was like to live without Jesus. It's much better with Jesus. Would you agree with that? So I get excited. I believe that if Jesus saved me, he can save anybody. So I get passionate. I may even get a little loud at times. But I want you to know, I'm one of those preachers, I welcome amens. I welcome praise the Lord's. I welcome hallelujahs. In fact, I'm going to make a deal with you. For every amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah, I hear, I'm going to take 30 seconds off the sermon. How about that? All right, amen. If you have something to write on and write with, would you go ahead and get that out? And the title of today's sermon is this: there's only one worthy of worship. There's only one worthy of worship. There's no participation trophies for false dead gods. There's one champion, and his name is Jesus. He is the only one worthy of our worship. And in Colossians, you got the Apostle Paul, who's writing this letter from prison, from preaching the gospel, and he's writing this letter to the church in Colossae because some false teachings about who Jesus is had crept into the church. So he reminds them of who Jesus is and how everything is about Jesus. So we're going to look real quick in Colossians 1 of six truths about Jesus and how he is the only one worthy of our worship. And I believe this, and I love that it's Revive Week. I believe this, our nation desperately needs revival. Would you agree with that? But our nation will never see revival until the churches in our nation see revival. And our churches will never see revival until the individuals who make up the church see revival in their life. See, revival always comes from God, but it comes through his people. And typically the way that God revives his people is reminding them of the greatness of Jesus and that we would follow him and go tell the world about him. So today, some of you, maybe this will be the first time you've ever heard this before, and you'll realize that you don't know this Jesus. And today, you're going to want to start a relationship with this Jesus, and you're going to have a moment to do that at the end of the service. Maybe some of you, you've heard about this 100 times, and you know a lot about Jesus, but you don't really know Jesus and have a personal relationship with him. There's a difference between knowing about Jesus and actually knowing Jesus. And in just a moment, you're going to have an opportunity to truly surrender to him and get to know him for the first time. Maybe others of you, you believe that you're a Christian because you go to a church building, or that you believe in the big man upstairs. You need to know God is not big man upstairs. He is holy God and deserves our worship. And so maybe today you know a lot of religious activity. You may even know all the right answers, but you don't have a relationship with Jesus. And in just a moment, you're going to have an opportunity to do that. Maybe for others of you today and the rest of us, we say we know Jesus, we love Jesus, we have the Holy Spirit. Well, I pray that this would be a reminder of who Jesus is, and that it would revive our affection for him, revive our joy and our love for him. Because here's what's true, friends. No matter how long you've been following Jesus, you don't mature past the gospel. You mature in the gospel. And maybe today we'd be reminded of how great Jesus is, and it would revive our hope and our love for him. Look at Colossians chapter 1, starting in verse 15. If you're there, say, uh-huh. We're going to jump right in. Here's Paul in verse 15. He says, he, now let's be clear who we're talking about. He, who is that? It's Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and say, we're talking about Jesus this morning. Tell him that. He, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God. So number one, would you write this down? Jesus makes the invisible God visible. Jesus makes the invisible God visible. Maybe there's been a time in your life where you are angry or confused, or maybe those in your life that aren't believers, maybe even challenge you with this, and people will say, hey, God, if you're real, then just show yourself. God, if you really exist, then just come down here. God, if you really love us, then prove it. Show yourself. You need to know that's exactly what God did in Jesus, that Jesus is God revealing himself. There's a name for Jesus that we love to use every year during Christmas, and it's the name Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. But that's a name that's true every single day, that he is God with us. If you want to know what God's like, look to Jesus. You want to know the heart of God, look to the heart of Jesus. Jesus isn't just sent from God. Jesus is God. We don't worship some God off in the distance. We worship a God that's very up close and personal. And there's all kind of opinions in culture today about who God is. Atheists say there is no God. Agnostics say there might be a God. Humanists say, let's remove God. Pornography says sex is God. Greed says money is God. Government says power is God. Pride says I am God. But the Bible teaches Jesus is God. He is God with us. He makes the invisible God visible. He is worthy of our worship. Number two, would you write this down? Jesus ranks above all of creation. Jesus ranks above all of creation. Look at verse 15 again. It says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all of creation. Now, firstborn over all creation, that can be confusing. In fact, there are some religions or some cults that teach Jesus is God's first created being. They'll say he's firstborn, therefore Jesus is God's first created being. Would you turn to your neighbor one last time, and I want you to look at him and say, that's a lie, don't believe that. Tell him that. Why? Because Jesus is not created. The Son of God is eternal. He is God. If you go to the beginning of it all, the Son of God is there. If you go to the end of it all, the Son of God is there. Jesus is God. And you go, well, Shane, what does that mean, firstborn then? What's that mean? Well, to really understand that, you got to understand the original language of the New Testament Greek, and that term firstborn in the Greek literally carries a rank, almost like a military rank. It means he's commander, he's over it all. So to really understand this, what this is saying is Jesus ranks above all of creation. There is no one like our Jesus. Out of all of creation, Jesus ranks above it all. The galaxies, the universe, the moon, the stars, the sun, earth, mountains, trees, your chihuahua. Jesus ranks above it all. There's no one like our Jesus. He is the Lord of all the lords. He is the King of all the kings, and there's no one like him. All throughout history, there's been kings. There was King David. There was King Solomon. There was King Henry. There was King James, not LeBron, the other King James. If you've ever seen the movie The Sandlot before, there was the King of Clout, Babe Ruth. The King of Rock, Elvis. The King of Pop, Michael Jackson. The Burger King. The Tiger King. It doesn't matter. They're all going to bow before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus. There's no one like our Jesus. No one like him. And here's some good doctrine and here's some good theology this morning. You know, we have an enemy, Satan. He's out to kill, steal, and destroy. But we need to understand this. Jesus and Satan are not equals playing chess against one another. Jesus is King. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is God. And even one day, Satan will bow at the feet of King Jesus before Jesus throws him into hell for all eternity. How many of you are ready for that day? I love what Billy Graham said. He goes, I read the end of the Bible. It works out good for those that know Jesus. You ever read Revelation 20? It doesn't work out good for Satan. Jesus is God. He is the only one worthy of our worship. There is no one like our Jesus. Number three, all things are through and for Jesus. Look at verse 16. I love verse 16. It's one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. And it says this, Paul says, for everything, you know what the word everything means in Greek? Everything, that's right. For everything was created by him in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. Look at this. All things have been created through him and what, church? For him. You literally were created for Jesus. The purpose of your existence is to know Jesus. You go, God, why am I here? What's the purpose of my existence? Why was I created? You were created to know Jesus. That's the purpose of our existence. And in fact, because of sin, and we'll talk more about this in a moment, we're all born with this Jesus-shaped hole in our soul, and we all feel this void, this emptiness, but we try to fulfill it with other things to be complete. So we'll go, and if I could just make more money, then I'll be fulfilled. If I could just get the job I wanted, I'll be fulfilled. If I could just get married, then I'd be fulfilled. If I could just have kids, then I'd be fulfilled. If my kids would move out, then I'd be fulfilled. If they would act right, I'd be fulfilled. If I could just get more followers on social media, if I could just make the varsity team, the starting lineup, and it's never enough. It's never enough because this is true, and I want you to write this down somewhere and never forget it because it's true every day of our life. You'll always feel like something is missing in your life as long as someone is missing in your life, and his name is Jesus. We literally exist for him. You know what else that means? It means it's not our life. It's not our life. Have you ever said that before? It's my life. I'll do with it what I want. Usually we said it when we were younger, growing up. Maybe we'd get in an argument with our mama right before we'd slam our bedroom door. We'd go, Mama, it's my life. I'll do with it what I want. Oh, and slam our bedroom door. Listen, the first time my kids slammed their bedroom door, that door's coming off the hinges, baby. All right? You're like, what about their privacy? Privacy comes with a four-letter word, R-E-N-T. You want some privacy? You better pay some rent up in here, right? But is it really our life? I want everybody to do this physical exercise with me, if you will. Would everybody just hold up your right hand, put it in front of your mouth, and breathe. I want you to feel that. Feel that breath. Let me ask you this. If it's really your life, what do you have to do with that breath? The answer is nothing. It began the moment God said. It will end the moment God says. It's his breath. Give it back to him in praise. Psalm 150 verse 6 says this. Let everything that has what, church? Breath. Praise the Lord. It's literally the purpose of your existence. Our mind was created to think about the greatness of Jesus. Our eyes were created to see the greatness of Jesus. Our heart was created to beat with passion for Jesus. Our hands were created to serve Jesus. Our knees were created to bow before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus. Our feet were created to follow Jesus. We exist for Jesus. And you always feel like something is missing as long as someone is missing. And his name is Jesus. We literally were created for him. Number four, real quick. Jesus is the sustainer of all things. He is the sustainer of all things. Not as only is Jesus the purpose of our existence, Jesus is also the power that holds us together. We don't worship some weak God. We worship an all-powerful God. Look at verse 17. He is before all things, and by him all things hold together. I love that. Hold together. We all go through difficult days. We all go through circumstances. We all go through suffering. Anybody ever received any bad news before? Reminds me of the guy who went to the doctor. The doctor goes, hey, I got bad news for you. And I got really bad news for you. And the guy goes, gosh, I guess give me the bad news first. The doctor goes, you got 24 hours to live. The guy goes, it gets worse than that? What's the really bad news? The doctor goes, I meant to call you yesterday. Hey, bad news. We've all received bad news. Just being honest with you, we have six kids, five here on earth, one with the Lord, as Pastor has already said. And our son, who we adopted from Uganda, had very severe special needs. And we adopted him when he was 6 months old, and he lived to be over 10. And with what he had, he lived longer than most kids do that suffers with what he does. And He went to be with the Lord last July. And I'll just be honest, that grief and watching him suffer, you know this, there's no kind of suffering like watching your kids suffer. And it's been really hard. Just being honest with you, it's been hard. Difficult circumstances. We all go through suffering. We all go through difficult circumstances. We all go through grief. But there's a God who loves us and a God who's with us. And God has been so good to us, even in the midst of suffering. Because here's what we know. Our son is with the Lord and the Lord is with us. And he's a loving God, but he's also a powerful God. In fact, during that time of extreme grief right after the immediate loss, I remember a song that I learned growing up. And I didn't even grow up in church, but I remember this song. And it just really reminded me of the power of God. Now, how many of you are so thankful for the great singers and the musicians up here? Don't you appreciate them and how they lead us to worship? Now, that's awesome, but I'm not a musician. I'm not a singer. I barely play the radio. You know what I mean? But I'm going to sing a song for y'all this morning. Is that okay? Can I sing a song for y'all? Now, here's what we're going to do, though. All right, we're going to do it together. Is I'm going to start the song. But I'm actually going to alley-oop it to you. I'm going to turn it over to you, and then you're going to take off singing the song loudly and proudly as only Quail Springs Baptist Church can do, all right? Now, I'll start it, and then I'm going to give it to you, and then you actually take over the song, all right? And you're going to go, well, Shane, how do I know if I know the song? If you grew up in church, you know this song. But even if you're like me and you didn't grow up in church, you're still going to know this song, all right? So I'm going to start, then you take over. Now, for the love of God, please do not leave me up here by myself because it's going to go terribly, all right? In light of the power of God, here's a great song. All right, you ready? He's got the whole world. Good job. Hey, give yourself a hand. Good job. You know why I love that song? It reminds us of how big God is, of how powerful God is. And we all go through suffering. We all go through difficulties. We all go through circumstances. But I want you to be reminded. If our God is so amazing, so big, and so powerful that he's got the whole world in his hands, don't you think he's also amazing enough and big enough and powerful enough to hold you together and sustain you when your whole world is falling apart around you? See, we're always telling God how big our circumstances are. Maybe it's time we start telling our circumstances how big our God is. He is the one who sustains us. He is the only one worthy of our worship. Never give your worship away to anything or anyone less than the best. And the best has a name, and it's the name above every name. It's the name Jesus Christ. Number five, real quick. Number five, Jesus is to be preeminent. He's to be first place. Look at verse 18. It says, he is also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. I'm reading from the Christian Standard Bible, the CSB. If you have the ESV, it may say preeminent. If you have another translation, it may say supreme. It means this: Jesus is to be preeminent, supreme, first place in every area of our life. When Jesus becomes your Savior, he also becomes your Lord, your boss, your King, your God. That means he now owns every area of your life. There's nothing off limits to him. Me and Jesus are not equals. He is God. He is Lord. Somebody once said it like this: he's either Lord of all or he ain't what? Lord at all in our life. There used to be this old bumper sticker. You'll probably remember it. I always used to see it on like the back of semi-trucks. But do you remember this bumper sticker? Jesus is my co-pilot. Do you remember that? No, he ain't. He's the pilot. He's the plane. He's the seats. By faith, we trust in him. He's King, he's Lord, he's God. He is boss. And the moment you say yes to Jesus at salvation, yes is the only answer you can ever give him again. See how this doesn't work? No, Lord. See how that doesn't work? No, King. No, God. That doesn't work. He's to have first place in everything. He is now the boss. And here's good news. Guess what?
He knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing.
And when I first learned that Jesus is to be first place, I don't know about you, I think I just went to a priority list. A lot of us, we were kind of taught that Jesus should be number one on our priority list. So it looked like this, right? Jesus number one, family number two, church number three, friends number four, job number five, hobby and sports number six. And especially growing up, my list looked like this. School, all the way at the stinking bottom, right? For Jesus to truly be Lord, for Jesus to truly be King, for Jesus to truly be preeminent and supreme and first place in our life, do not miss this. Jesus does not belong on a priority list. For Jesus to truly be first place and to truly be Lord and King, it means this. He owns the whole priority list. So it looks like this. Jesus number one in my family. Jesus number one in my job. Jesus number one in my relationships. Jesus number one in my hobbies. Jesus number one in every area of my life. I want you to write this down. Jesus does not desire to be a part of our life. Jesus desires to be our life, and that's radically different. It's Jesus. He is life. He is to be preeminent. And then number six, only Jesus can save us. He is the only one worthy of our worship because only he can save us. Don't give your worship away to anyone or anything less than the best, and the best has a name, and that name is Jesus. You'll always feel like something's missing in your life as long as what? Someone is missing, and his name is what, church? Jesus. Only he can save us. Look at verses 19 and 20. I love this. It says, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, meaning Jesus is fully God. Again, he isn't just sent from God. Jesus is God. He's not 99% God. He's 100% God. Verse 20, and through him to reconcile everything to himself, whether things on earth or things in heaven. And I love this part, making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Would you read that with me out loud on three? One, two, three, making peace through his blood shed on the cross. How many of you are thankful for the cross of Jesus Christ? How many of you are thankful for the blood that washes away our sin? We all got a big problem, and it's called a sin problem because of our great-great-great ancestors, Adam and Eve. If you get on ancestry.com, we all end up at Adam and Eve. And they rebelled against God, and the moment they did, the power of sin entered humanity and then spread like a virus to every person born after Adam and Eve. And you go, well, Shane, what does that mean to me in Oklahoma in 2024? It's what this means to us today, is that because of sin, we were all born sinners separated from our Creator God. We were all born spiritually dead, meaning there's nothing we can do to fix this spiritual problem of sin because we were born spiritually dead, and dead people are good at what? Being dead. That means there's nothing we can do to fix this on our own power. It also means this, no one in this room was born a Christian. Christianity is not something you're born into. It's something you have to be reborn into, saved into. And I think especially in the South, I'm from Texas, so I understand, especially in the South, I think this is where we get it wrong a lot. Have you ever been talking to somebody before and you go, hey man, when did you become a Christian? And they go, oh brother, I've always been a Christian. When people say they've always been a Christian, that means they probably never truly understood the gospel. You go, I've always been a Christian. What they mean by that is ever since they were in their mother's womb, they went to some building that had a steeple on top or a cross on the side. Now, Coral Springs, this is an amazing building. But let me ask you this. Does sitting inside of this church building make you a Christian? Just like sitting inside of McDonald's does not make you a Happy Meal. We understand that, right? Buildings don't make Christians. Jesus does. We were born sinners in need of a Savior. There's something wrong with us. It's called sin. In fact, we all need to get on the same page. There are no holier than thou's here. Maybe this is your first time to visit church and you go, I bet these are all perfect people. No, we're all sinners in need of a Savior. There's something wrong with us. In fact, let's all get on the same page. In fact, I'll raise my hand. How many of you say, hey, Shane, there's something wrong with me? Anybody want to admit that? You know what that is? It's sin. How many of you are sitting next to someone and there's definitely something wrong with that person, right? What is it? Sin. Some of you are looking at me right now going, well, Shane, you don't know me. I'm a good person. Well, the Bible says you should not tell a lie. So raise your hand if you've ever told a lie before. If you're not raising your hand, you're lying right now. We're all sinners. We're all good at it. In fact, we're all so good at sinning, we're experts at justifying our sin, aren't we? Have you ever noticed when other people sin, we become judges? But when we sin, we become defense attorneys? We all compare sin. You're like, hey, I know I ain't perfect, but at least I ain't as bad as John is. He's a big sinner. No, we're all big sinners in need of a Savior. And here's good news. We may be big sinners, but there's a bigger Savior named Jesus. And let me say this too, because this is such a relevant word for today. Self-help does not solve spiritual problems. Because at the heart of every problem is a heart problem, and only God can change the heart. You know why self-help doesn't help often? Because often the biggest problem with self is self. If self is the problem, self can't be the solution. We need someone outside of self. His name is Jesus. Now, we may be good at sinning, but Jesus is better at saving. Jesus is a better Savior than we are sinner. Can I get a witness up in here today? That 2,000 years ago, the Son of God, who has always existed, took a mission trip from heaven to earth and became a man to die as a man for mankind, but never stopped being God. Fully God, fully man. He lived a perfect sin-free life that you and I could not live. And then he did the greatest act of love ever. He took our place on the cross. And friends, don't ever get over that. We are sinners. He is sinless. We are messed up. He is perfect. Yet he loved us so much, he took our place as a perfect sacrifice of our sin, as a perfect substitute in our place. When they shoved the crown of thorns on his head, that should have been me. When they spit in his face, that should have been you. When they nailed him to the cross, that should have been all of us. But our great God loved us so much, he took our place. And according to verse 20, what? Making peace through his what? Blood shed on what? The cross. He died there. Then they took his lifeless body off the cross and put it in a borrowed grave. Now, Quell Springs, this next part should make us yell so loudly the whole state of Oklahoma hears us. You know why they put the body of Jesus in a borrowed grave? Because he wasn't going to need it long. Because 3 days later, our Jesus busted out of the grave, showing that God the Father had accepted God the Son's sacrifice on our behalf. Jesus made the way possible to be forgiven. Jesus made the way possible to have eternal life. Jesus made the way possible to live out our purpose, which is to worship God. Jesus made the way possible for God to come live inside of us. The tomb is empty, but the throne of God is full of the risen King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus. Jesus lives. And because the tomb is empty, we can be full of the life of Christ. Jesus lives, so hope lives. Jesus lives, so peace lives. Jesus lives, so joy lives. Jesus lives, so love lives. Jesus lives. And according to the Bible, all those who repent and believe can know this Jesus. Repent means to have a change of heart, change of mind, where you realize I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I cannot fix this. No amount of good deeds. I can't save myself, so I'm going to place my faith, my trust in Jesus to do for me what I cannot do for myself. And the moment I surrender to Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life, he places his Holy Spirit in me. The same power that ripped Jesus out of the grave comes to live inside of us. And when God comes to live inside of us, that's the good news of the gospel. We get God. God loves us so much, he wants to give us his very best, himself. And when God moves in, he brings some things with him. Like forgiveness, that we are forgiven of past, present, future sins. That means when Jesus saves us today, he's already factored in our stupidity of tomorrow. How amazing is that grace? When the Holy Spirit of God comes to live inside of us, we get hope, peace, love, and joy because all those things come with God. We get to live out the purpose of our life, which is to know and to worship the Lord. When the Holy Spirit of God comes to live inside of us, our soul, our spirit that was spiritually dead now becomes spiritually alive. We go from death into life. Real life. Eternal life doesn't start one day. It starts now. We get eternal life now. The gospel of Jesus Christ is not about making good people better. It's about making dead people alive. And only our Jesus can do that. Only he can save us. He is the only one worthy of our worship. Don't give your worship away to anyone less than the best. And the best has a name, and that name is Jesus. And you'll always feel like something is missing. As long as someone is missing, and his name is what, church? Jesus. But we hear that, and we're a stubborn people. And a lot of times we'll make excuses of why we can't fully surrender to Jesus as Lord and Savior of our life. So in closing, I'm going to give you five real quick common excuses people use for not surrendering to Jesus as Lord and Savior of their life. And maybe it's an excuse you're using. It's excuses I've used before. Five excuses of why people won't fully surrender to Jesus as Lord and Savior of their life. Excuse number one, they'll say this: Jesus can't forgive me. He can't forgive me. I'm here to tell you, yes, he can. And you go, well, Shane, my sin is big. I understand. So is mine. But the grace of God is bigger. You go, Shane, my sin is deep. I get it. So is mine. But the love of Jesus is deeper. You go, Shane, you don't know what I've done. You're right. I don't know what you've done, and you don't know what I've done, but I know what Jesus has done, and it's enough for you. He is God, and he can do anything. He can forgive you. And not only can Jesus forgive you, he wants to forgive you. You just have to be willing. Number two, people say, I'll just wait till later. I'll just wait till later. Every year I get to travel all across the nation and speak to a lot of young people, teenagers, college students, young adults, and they'll say that. Shane, I'll just wait till later. I know I need to follow Jesus. I know I need to surrender to him, but I want to wait till later. I just want to kind of do my own thing right now. I just want to live it up. But whenever I get older, when I get married, have kids, I'll wait till later. And maybe even you as an adult, you're thinking of that, going, well, I gotta do some things first. I gotta clean up some things. I gotta do this business deal. I gotta focus on some other things. Shane, I'll do that later. I'll do that later. And I'm not trying to scare you, but I love you enough to be honest. None of us are guaranteed later. We're not guaranteed older. We're not guaranteed tomorrow or the drive home. We're not guaranteed our next breath. Here's what I know. As long as you have life and breath in your lungs, you have an opportunity to confess Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. But the moment that breath stops, it's too late. Don't put off till later what God is calling you to now, because you're not guaranteed later. Number three, people say this: well, Shane, I just want to stay in the middle. I just want to stay in the middle. Listen, Shane, I just leave all the religious stuff to my wife. I just leave all the religious stuff to my husband. I just leave all the religious stuff to my kids or my parents or my pastor or my friends. Listen, I'm just not very religious. I'm no Satan worshiper, but I don't want to be any odd for God Jesus freak. I just hang in the middle. Shane, I just kind of hang in the middle. Please hear me this morning. There is no middle. Jesus said himself in the Gospel of Matthew, you're either with me or against me. Here's what I promise you. One day you will draw your last breath. You will stand before the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and here's what he will not do. He will not do this. He will not go, hey, great job. You hung out in the middle. You're the best middle person I've ever seen. No, he'll either say, well done, good and faithful servant. That's for those who knew Jesus and followed Jesus. Or you'll hear the most nightmare statement of all time that will ring in your ears for all eternity when he says, depart from me, I never knew you. And you spend an eternity separated from all the goodness of God in a literal place called hell. Yes, heaven is for real, but so is hell, and Jesus makes the difference. There is no middle. Listen, sometimes being in the middle means you're all the way out. Number four, people go, I just want to party in hell. I just want to party with the devil. I don't care if I go to hell. That's where all my friends are going to be. And I used to say that. I didn't become a Christian until I was 21. And so high school and college, I was partying a lot. And I would get drunk or high with my friends. And just being honest, here's what we'd say. We don't care if we go to hell. All of our friends are going to be there. We're going to party in hell. It's going to be a big party. That's where all of our friends are. We're going to party with the devil. How ignorant were we? See, because in Luke, Jesus also tells the story of a guy in hell. And he's under so much torment that he's literally pleading with one drop of water to be placed upon his tongue. I don't know about you, that does not sound like a party. But you know where the party's going to be? In heaven, at the throne of God, where the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is, and we get to see Jesus face to face for all eternity, and there'll be no more suffering, there'll be no more weeping, there'll be no more mourning, there'll be no more handicapped parking spaces, there'll be no more insurance copays, there'll be no more viruses or diseases, there'll be no more evil or hatred. We will only know the goodness of God. That's where the party's gonna be. And then number five excuse people say, well, Shane, I can't surrender to Jesus. I can't go all in because Jesus can't change me. Jesus can't change me. Shane, I've been the same way my whole life. I've tried everything. This is just who I am. Jesus can't change me. Yes, he can. He is God, and nothing is impossible for him. Not only can Jesus change you, Jesus wants to change you. And I'm not asking you today to try harder to be a better person. In fact, I'm telling you, stop trying and start trusting in Jesus to do for you what you cannot do for yourself. Because here's what I believe about Jesus. You're not too lost for Jesus to find. You're not too dirty for Jesus to cleanse. You're not too broken for Jesus to fix. You're not too wounded for Jesus to heal. You're not too far gone for Jesus to reach. You're not too guilty for Jesus to forgive. And you're not too sinful for Jesus to save. That's what I believe. So maybe you're here today and you go, Shane, I've never heard this before. But I want to know that Jesus. I want to follow him. Well, then now's your time. Maybe you're here and you go, Shane, I've heard this 100 times, but today it just hit differently. And I realize I don't know that Jesus, but I want to. Now's your time. Maybe you're here and you go, Shane, I've just been in the middle. I've just been playing a game. I've just been in the middle. But today, by faith, I want to go all the way in. Now's your time. Maybe you're here and you go, Shane, I thought I was a Christian because I went to a church building and I believe in God, but today I realize I don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, and I want to. Now's your time. Maybe you're here today and you go, Shane, I'm not really sure if I know Jesus. I'm not really sure if I were to die today, I would go to heaven, and I don't want to leave this building without being for sure and knowing Jesus, but then now's your time. Only Jesus can save us. Only Jesus can save us. And you'll always feel like something's missing as long as someone is missing. And his name is Jesus. Let us pray with heads bowed, eyes closed. I'm going to ask our ministers to just come forward and make themselves available. And you go, Shane, I believe today God's calling me to be saved. I believe God's calling me to start a relationship with Jesus through repentance and faith. I believe God's calling me today to be forgiven and have eternal life and a brand new start. Well, here's what I'm going to ask you to do is I'm going to ask you to trust the Bible. The Apostle Paul says in Romans 10:9, he says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So we're just going to trust this. So if that's you today, with heads bowed, eyes closed, by faith, believing in your heart, would you open your life to Jesus? And we're going to confess with our mouth and pray because that's what the Bible tells us to do, and I'm going to help you. Now listen, there's no power in just repeating a prayer. You can repeat a prayer for the rest of your life and not truly mean it. What matters is that you believe it with your heart right now. And then we're going to confess, and I can help you. You can either pray with me quietly or out loud. Now listen, you're not confessing to me. I'm a nobody. You're just confessing with me to the risen Lord. So if that's you right now and you say, Shane, today's the day I believe, whether I've heard it the first time, the 1,000th time, in the middle, one insurance, whatever. You believe that God's calling you to repent of your sin and to trust in him this morning for salvation. You want to start that relationship with Jesus and truly know the real Jesus this morning. Then with heads bowed, eyes closed, believing with your heart, would you just confess this with me either quietly or out loud? You can just say this with me. Just say this. Just say, God. You can say that with me up in the balcony. Say, God, either quietly or out loud. Say, God, I admit I'm a sinner. But today, I believe in Jesus. I believe he is Lord. I believe he is alive. I repent of my sin. God, would you come live inside of me? Forgive me of sin. Change me from the inside out. I want to know you. I want to follow you. I want to worship you. Thank you for saving me right now. With heads bowed, eyes closed, you know, in Luke 15, it says, the angels in heaven rejoice when one sinner repents. And we've gotten to see people do it in every service, and I believe that God's done it in here. So I believe people in this room have repented. So that means there's a party going on in heaven right now because of what God's doing in this room, and I just want to join that celebration. Also, Jesus died boldly and publicly for us, so it's time for us by faith to live boldly and publicly for him. So if you just confess with me, and you truly meant it, with heads bowed, eyes closed, and no one looking around, right now, if you confess with me and prayed with me, and you truly meant it, right now, would you just boldly put your hand in the air, put it up high, lock out your elbow, and by doing that, you're saying, Shane, I prayed with you, I confess with you, and I truly meant it. Just put up your hand up high, lock out your bow, and leave it up. All right, I see one over here, over there. Yeah, I see over there too, I see in there. Leave your hand up, leave your hand up. I see multiple hands over there. Yep, over in this section. Over in this section, up in the balcony. Yeah, I see hands in the balcony as well. Yeah, I see that, I see that. All right, multiple hands. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. If you got your hand up, you're not alone. I just want you to look up and meet eyes with me. And then listen, hey, welcome to the family of God. 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 Up there in the balcony, I saw you. Welcome to the family of God. I see you, my brother. I see you. Welcome to the family of God. Now, listen, we're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to do anything to embarrass you. We just want to talk to you, pray with you, give you some next steps. And you're not alone. There's multiple of you that raise your hand. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. With no one else looking around, if you looked up at me, you raise your hand, and you truly meant it this morning, right where you are, would you just stand up? Just stand up. Go ahead. Stand up, my brother. Go ahead. Stand up. Go ahead. Stand up, my brother. Stand up. I see you, sis. Go ahead. Stand up. Stand up. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Is with no one around you worried about that, hey, listen, this is a celebration moment. Here's what I want you to do. With no one else looking, and this won't embarrass you, but no one else looking, I just want you to tell the person next to you, excuse me, and I want you to just make your way up here and come stand by one of our ministers as they're going to pray with you and help you. Come on, my brother. You can come down from the balcony. Come on, come on. Yep, just come on. Hey, listen, if you want a friend or family or somebody to come with you, hey, you just bring them with you. Hey, if you are standing by somebody or sitting by somebody that prayed and you want to come with them, you come with them. Come on. Come on. People are coming. You can come. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Now, maybe you confessed with me or prayed with me and you're a little nervous to go by yourself and you didn't even raise your hand or look up and you want somebody to come with you, just lean over and say, hey, I prayed with Shane, I confessed with Shane. Would you come with me? And friend, family, you bring them. You stand up with them and you bring them. Come on, come on. Now, how many of you would say this? How many of you say, Shane, I know without a doubt I'm a Christian, but I believe today God revived my heart. As he reminded me of who Jesus is, he just revived my heart and brought me closer to him. How many of you could say that this morning? Hands all over the room, just raise your hand. I believe God said, yeah, God impacted me. Yeah, that's amazing. Hey, maybe you're here today and you need to talk to somebody about being baptized next Sunday. You go, hey, I've never followed in baptism. Or my baptism was on the wrong side of salvation. I got baptized when I was young, got saved later, and I need to get my baptism on the right side of my salvation. We want you to come. Here's what I'm going to do, friends, is I'm going to pray and say amen. And the moment I say amen, we want you to stand. And the invitation's not over. It's just beginning. So if you need to come to talk to somebody about making a decision for the Lord, you need to be saved, you need to talk to somebody about being baptized, you want to pray with somebody, recommit your life, you come. But if you're not making a decision, here's what I'm going to ask you to do, and we've done it every service, is if you're physically able, the moment I say amen, would you come and find a place at the altar? We say at the beginning, we need revival. But every revival starts with prayer. We should never talk to people about God until we talk to God about people. It all starts with prayer. Every awakening starts with prayer. And so in just a moment, if you're physically able, could you come and get on your hands and knees at the altar? Now listen, I know it's just wooden carpet, but when it's covered with the tears and the prayers of the saints, it becomes an altar unto God. And here's what we're going to pray. We're going to ask God to revive us, to bring revival to our lives, our church, our communities, our families, our nation, and the nations, for the name and the fame and the glory of King Jesus. So I'm going to pray, and the moment I say amen, if you need to make a decision, you come. The ministers are going to be here. Come find a place at the altar otherwise and pray, but be obedient to what God's called you to. God, you're an amazing God. We thank you. You're mighty to save. We thank you for the life, death, burial, resurrection of you, King Jesus. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you're the one that opens our eyes and our ears to the need of a Savior, and you dwell inside of us, making us the church. So God, would you bring those, Father, who need to make a decision this morning? God, we thank you for the ones that have already come. We praise you for that. We pray for those who will be speaking and praying to them. For others that need to come, would you give them the faith and obedience to respond? And then for the rest of us, would we hit our knees praying? And God, would you revive us and revive our churches and revive our communities and revive our nation and the nations for your name, fame, and your glory, because you deserve this. We pray this in the name above every name, Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit. And the church said, amen. Would you stand and come and respond and be obedient to what God's called you to today? Come on.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence day.
Before the Lord, as the music continues to play, we've heard the Lord speak to us today. People today in this service have come forward to say they trusted Jesus as Savior because they called on His name and asked Him. And there are others in this room, and you prayed that prayer with Shane, and you still need to come. You can come as even as I'm speaking, and as the music plays, you can come. We're here waiting for you at the front. You come. Others of you are here and God is moving in your life, and this has just been a time in your life to recommit yourself to the Lord. And God is working, and He's going to continue to work in the days to come. So we want to seek Him. We want to hear His voice. We want to know His heart. Lord God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for speaking to us in such a powerful way. Thank you, Lord, for boys and girls who trusted Jesus as Savior. Thank you, Lord, for men and women who today have trusted Jesus as Savior. And Lord, I thank you that you take our lives as we give them to you and you change them by the power of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. Thank you for reminding us that you can forgive us of anything and that you can change us and save anyone who comes to you. We praise you for that. God, we give you glory and honor for the way you've worked in this place today. For we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. And church, if you agree with that prayer, will you say amen? Amen. Church family, will you express your appreciation to Shane Pruitt? Thank you, Brother Shane. Brother Shane, we just thank God for you. I'm thankful you've been here with us today, and God's used you in such an incredible way. Brother Shane is it's amazing how God is using him, and he has a lot of things ahead of him even this week. But one of the things I would love for this church to be praying for Shane about has to do with something that I'm involved in. Many of you know I'm serving as the president of our Southern Baptist Convention Pastors Conference this year. Shane is going to be one of our speakers for the Pastors Conference. He'll have the opportunity to preach a message to probably between 4,500 and 6,000 pastors who will be there for that pastor's conference. If you will agree to pray for him, will you just say, I will? I will. And Brother Shane, we'll be praying for you in the days ahead. Thank you for coming and investing in us today and preaching God's word. This morning is just the beginning of our week of Revive services. Tonight, we'll continue at 5:30 in the worship center. Our guest preacher is going to be someone who is a good friend, someone we love very much and know very well. Dr. Jeff DiGiacomo will be preaching for us tonight. He served for so many years here at Quail Springs and now is the senior pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church in Shawnee. God's using him in an incredible way there. Our guest musical artist is songwriter and recording artist Patrick Mayberry. You don't want to miss that. So pray about what God wants to do even tonight. Plan on being here and invite someone to be with you. And I do want to remind you, even after our services are dismissed, the invitation is still open. I'll be right out these doors. Brother Shane will be here at his book table. We'll be there at the welcome desk for several minutes after services are over. If you prayed that prayer and asked Jesus to save you, don't leave this place without telling someone. We've got a Bible we want to give you to help you take your next steps with Jesus. We want to pray with you and just talk to you about what it means to follow Jesus. It'll just take a moment, but if you pray that prayer and have not let someone know about your decision, come by that desk and let us know. Let's pray together and then we'll be dismissed. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you, God, for working. Thank you, God, for saving. As we go out from this place, may we go out with the name of Jesus upon our lips. Lord, give us an opportunity to share a good word for Jesus and a good word about what you are doing here at Quail Springs. Lord, we pray that we would go out in the power of your Holy Spirit who lives within us. And may we live our lives to you, to your glory, Father, for we belong to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.